So is London over? We'll go at this question from many different directions, no doubt, in our discussion this evening. But there is a certain, you know, gravity. So we, you know, you can build a box at the wrong end of Canning Town, and it will be sold off plan elsewhere in the world, and it will no doubt be marketed with symbols, those icons of London, like the Queen and Buckingham Palace, the Tower Bridge, and so on. And it will be a secure place to invest. So there is a certain reality to the claim, you know, that London is indeed secure and its future is secure. And so those counterclaims that we might make about the way that property speculation is building the wrong kinds of developments in relation to our needs, nonetheless, tell a story about London's resilience. So we want to explore that claim that maybe, you know, you can even have a fire of London, and that London is so strong that it would be rebuilt, set against a number of the threats that exist that we will no doubt explore this evening. So that's what we're about. This session is sponsored by the City of London Corporation, to whom we're extremely grateful. And I just want to introduce to you my panelists before I get them to say some words in introduction. So first of all, on my immediate right, Alex Benson is the director of the Block Nightclub. Alex has a background in rave promotion, and he founded the Block Festival in 2007, bringing, as you know, thousands of people together. You know about rave culture. In 2012, he found a home for Block in Hackney Wick, on the fringe of the Olympic Park and Stratford, and has become part of what in many ways is the latest wave of development of London towards its east, remaking the use of a disused furniture factory, rather, which in a way speaks to something that we might explore about the nature of the London economy. Next to Alex, we have Mark Berliat from the City of London Corporation. Mark is the policy chairman of the City of London Corporation. He chairs the Policy and Resources Committee, where he's been a member since 2002. He's the deputy chairman of the City UK and the International Regulatory Strategy Group. He's the vice chairman of London Councils. And he's also, I think, very relevant for this evening's discussion. He's a member of the boards of the Central London Forward and of London and Partners, both promotional bodies for London in relation to both, you know, the domestic story about London, but also importantly its international story. Next to Mark, we have Jessica Firm. Jessica is a lecturer in planning and urban management at University College London, a lecturer at the Bartlett School of Planning, a prestigious planning institution right here in London, and specialises in spatial planning, economic development, and social sustainability. Jessica's particularly interested in the contribution of small businesses and informal activities to the quality of urban life here in London. And I know Jessica from being involved with the Greater London Authority in some discussions about the threats to workspace for business in general and for creative space in particular. And I think that Jessica was at the front of thinking about how the city might respond to what are fast disappearing sectors of economic and social activity in our city. Next to Jessica, we have Don Levitt. Don Levitt is the executive director of Non Paribas and is also the author of a book called It Took Another Riot. You know, I mentioned the fire of London. If you think about the contemporary motif for London burning, It wouldn't take you long to think about the riots in 2011, and I think that Don has written some extremely useful reflections on those riots, and indeed has worked with a number of people to reflect on what kind of challenge that was to the social life of our city. In 2014, he, in his guise with Non-Parabas, a site that's devoted to exploring the major policy challenges facing Western governments in the modern world. And in that context, he, in 2014, ran the first major conference on the potential commercial impact of Brexit for the London economy. So, Don Levitt. And then, last but not least, on Don's right, there is Munira Mirza. Many of you will know Munira because she was the former Deputy Mayor of London for Education and Culture. She's also an author of a book called The Politics of Culture, The Case for Universalism, and is now remains very active in London life. She's an advisor on arts and philanthropy. You will know, no doubt, that Munira continues to play a very public role in discussions about London and its future. So that's our panel. What I'm going to do is to ask each of our panelists to say something, to reflect on the title of the session and to say some things for a few minutes. And then I will, as soon as I can, basically throw the discussion over to you and see what you've got to pick up on from the themes that have been raised. So to start off with, Alex.
Hello everyone, how are you? My approach to the question is London over, is to think of the London that I know and work with every day. That's cultural East London for the main part. I run two businesses that are relevant to this discussion. First of all, we've talked about the rave venue that Michael kindly introduced, but I also take out long leases on old warehouses in Hackney Wick, strip them out, and then renovate them for use by creative entrepreneurs. So we provide a home for artists, graphic designers, architects, music producers, the kind of people who bring the cultural capital to the city, I like to think. As I understand it, the notion that London is somehow finished culturally is because it stands accused of becoming a bloated, cultureless void. The narrative runs that once there was space for penniless and sexy artists to rent drafty warehouses for pennies. They could subsist in their creative communities and support themselves in London. Then, a Bulgarian class of empty-headed stiffs moves in. Probably because they read about how cool summer was in Time Out. They drive up the rents, knock down the old buildings, and replace them with glass-fronted, vibeless coffee shops. Now, our brave rave promoters, struggling artists, and the zippy young startups can't be part of this sterile dystopia. They can no longer afford to be in Hackney or Stoke Newington or Shoreditch or Manor House, so they quit London and disperse, and so hence cultural London is over. These people, with the creative and entrepreneurial zeal that drove them to turn furniture factories into nightclubs and peanut factories into art studios and basement boiler rooms into global media networks, choosing to abandon the nucleus of the largest and most influential city in Western Europe and instead go somewhere else just because the rent is higher than it used to be. I don't think it makes any sense. I think that this theory only holds water if you put the blinkers on and look at one particular area, if you focus at areas which now no longer have as many creatives in as they used to. London's a gargantuan, mutating metropolis. Has areas which are lovely, areas which are less so, areas which are dry as a bone, and areas which are alive with noise and ideas. The city's been changing since it was founded, is in a permanent state of transition, and it does not have to have one perfect form that will last forever. It's sad to see a specific area lose its sparkle. Certainly, I've seen that happen to a lot of my favourite places and my favourite nightclubs especially. Some developments have been cruel and poorly managed. However, just to do the work I do at my workspace site with its 50 studios and 600 capacity nightclub, I meet and work with hundreds of DJs and promoters and creative entrepreneurs all the time. Their drive and ambition have meant that They have assessed the situation up the road and instead opted to join a more functional community in a new area that meets their needs. I run just one site, and that's in Hackney Wick, Fish Island. There are five more sites just like it. They're all filled with people. All of their businesses are doing very well, and all of them have not left the city which doesn't look after them, but turned their back on gentrifying areas which no longer work for them. Cultural London is very much alive and well. Far from being over, the London that I see every day and the people I work with are just getting warmed up. At the heart of our community is the nightclub that we started. Whenever we have an artistic community, a social and cultural space which sits in the middle of it, provides a fantastic nucleus for people to work around and which influences people and holds them together. Nightlife has always been a very key part of regeneration in East London. And I would like to see more nightlife sponsored and supported by the inevitable developments as they go through East London. I believe that development is an inevitable part of these gentrifying areas. However, that development can be guided to support the spaces into which it goes, and it doesn't need to mean that we end up with these sterile city areas that I described.
I did feel the novelist in Alex appearing there, and then I noticed the project manager as he appeared succinctly on time. That's great. Thank you, Alex. So, Mark.
Thanks, and now you've got the boring man from the City of London. No, London is absolutely not over and never will be. But that's as long as we continue with everything that's made London the great city that it has become over the last 30 or 40 years. And I've been around for so long. When I started in London as an immigrant, you know, Britain was the sick man of Europe, and London wasn't a very attractive place to be. And frankly, even 10, 15 years ago, when I became very active in the city, Cheapside was not a place that anybody wanted to be. I've been through it today. It's thriving and very active. Indeed, the City of London was regarded as being a desert after about 5 o'clock, where the pub shut at 8 o'clock. Now, we tend to have a bit of the opposite problem. It's a bit too lively at times, late at night. But London has suffering from the problems of success. People want to be in London because it is the greatest city in the world. They come from everywhere else in the world and this country. People come to work for me in the city from places as far away as Leeds. Well, not just Leeds. Liberia was the one I saw last week. But to keep that position, London has got to be open, and this applies to anywhere in the world. If you want to be part of a successful community in the future, whether it is a country, a town, a bit of a town, a school, or even a house, you have got to be open. Open to the best ideas, the most interesting people, modern technology and everything. Being open, being adaptable, being flexible, and being inclusive. And London is very inclusive in many ways. I'm an immigrant, but actually I'm an immigrant from Jersey, which is quite a nice place. I'm not a tax exile. I was born there. My parents did not consult me. Had they consulted me, I would have been born somewhere else. And I say jokingly about my home of Jersey, which I really love, that if your family have been there 300 years, you're almost a local. London about 3 days, and you're a Londoner. And that, I think, is absolutely the great thing about London, and let's keep it that way. And we need to be inclusive, not just for the people who come from afar and who adapt very quickly, but inclusive to the people in London. And we do have particularly far too many young people for whom London does not provide them with what they want. Our education system is fantastic in London. London has gone from having the worst schools in the country to the best. And we're very proud, particularly of our three academies that we run from the city in Hackney, Islington and Southwark. But there's a lot more to do to help young people be equipped for the world of work tomorrow, which is not about having 5 GCSEs, including English and maths. It's about the key work skills we're going to need in the future. Analysis, analytical skills, knowledge of technology, communication skills. That's what's going to be the driving force behind the successful communities of the future. London needs to be connected. We could do with a new runway. We've only been saying this for 50 years. And there's a possibility that next week the government will announce the date when it will make the next announcement about the next delay. before we finally build a runway, and we'll have 4 years of planning inquiries and no doubt other thing, and we'll build a runway in 10 minutes with the help of Chinese contractors afterwards. So that's going too far. We need to be connected. And in terms of electronic connectivity, we in this country should aspire to be like Estonia and Lithuania. And how embarrassing it is to have to say that, but we need to do it. A quick word about Brexit, because all of my speeches now cover Brexit. A bad Brexit could be really damaging for London. A good Brexit will not be damaging, because London has got a whole load of things that make it very attractive to not just people, but institutions from around the world. We've got some of the greatest universities in the world, and yet I fear that our visa policy is badly hindering what should be a stunningly successful industry. Just inviting people in to study and then kick them out at the end is not a great idea. Our life sciences industry is fantastic, again, world leading. And the creative industries, everything I can see about London is very creative. And can I add sport as well? Really important. Yeah. You haven't mentioned sport. I'm biased. My rugby team kicked off 5 minutes ago. And what did I have to do today? Could I be watching Saracens or being here? And I chose to be here. Well, all right, bit of sympathy for me, I thought, right? But also the sector we represent in the city is about financial and professional services. You know, and that's not about a load of bankers. That's providing employment for thousands and thousands of people, not just in London, but throughout the country. London needs all of these things to be great. We need jobs. We need creative industries. We need culture. Our housing we have to improve, and I've no doubt we'll talk about that more. London is suffering from the problems of success, and it's far better to have those than the problems of failure. If you want to see a city nobody wants to live in, it's got low house prices, falling house prices, plenty of open space. London is not like that. It's buzzing, absolutely buzzing. And compared with 20 years ago, this bit of London is more buzzing than ever.
Thank you, Mark. Jessica.
Okay, hi. So my starting point when I thought about this question is London over? I thought, well, when would London be considered over for me? And I thought, well, when it can no longer spawn new ideas, when there's no longer potential for the unexpected, when it loses its diversity of people, of jobs, of things to do, if it contains little more than a homogenous expanse of housing, when it has become the victim of its own success. So my perspective, as Michael said, is around the provision of workspace and accommodation. So thinking about where London works. And I'm very interested in what role planning has in all of this, if any. So that's my sort of starting point. But as an academic, I thought it might be useful to try and be neutral and to set out, in a sense, the two schools of thought around this question. So the first I will call the sort of hands-off the market school of thought. And there are two sort of rather perhaps sort of contrasting positions within under this banner. So the first is the one which you will hear from mainstream economists and our current government at the moment, possibly from Mark, which would say that, you know, in cities where the economy is prospering, such as London, less skilled, lower paid jobs get squeezed out and they get replaced by better paid, higher skilled jobs. And cities that are not losing lower paid jobs have stagnant economies. They're not successful. Competition for space in the city is a natural market process. City districts or neighborhoods rise and fall. We've seen the decline of Soho, the rise of Shoreditch, the decline of Shoreditch, the rise of other areas of London. And this is not necessarily to be mourned. It means that another part of the city, or perhaps even another city altogether, will benefit from economic activity that is displaced. And economists call this spillover. Another position, which is also very anti-planning in a sense, comes from Jane Jacobs. You might have heard of her. She wrote a book called The Death and Life of Great American Cities back in the 1960s. And a nice quote from her says, "Unless they are handsomely financed to start with or instantly successful, new ideas tumble into second-best locations, thereby second-best becomes first-rate, flourishes for a time, and eventually it too is destroyed by the duplication of its own greatest successes." Now, the difference between these two positions is that in the first, it doesn't really see loss of diversity as a problem, that sort of mainstream economist position. But Jane Jacobs did see loss of diversity as a problem. She saw diversity as something to be embraced. But she assumed that there would always be somewhere else for these activities to go, and that in going there, they would fuel the cycle of regeneration or gentrification. We might want to think of it that way. So that's the hands off the market position. The other position is that we need to plan for diversity so that there is a role for planning, let's say. And this position would say that left to its own devices, the market will eventually eradicate lower value activities and the diversity we have. The world we live in today means that this process is being accelerated. So in 1960s New York, when Jane Jacobs was writing, the market could be left to its own devices, and there were still plenty of second-rate places left. But what happens when the process of replacement continues to such an extent that the ingredients that made the city successful in the first place are lost? Might we run out of second-rate parts of the city to spill over into? It's a question. So today, the scale of global investment in the real estate market favours large-scale luxury residential developments and monolithic office environments, neither of which are conducive to supporting a diversity of enterprise. Residential land values are 3 times industrial land values across London and up to 8 times in the centre. The money to be made, particularly when residential is permitted on an industrial site, means that businesses are not being upgraded gradually as industries go into decline, but decline is somewhat being manufactured. And unfortunately, planning policy in many places is reinforcing this manufactured decline in the name of regeneration. In the past 5 years, we've lost 500 hectares of industrial land, mostly to housing, and this is nearly 3 times the target in the London plan. In central London, it's almost 8 times the target in the London plan. So it means something over and above the decline in manufacturing industrial jobs that is going on is taking place here. But the problem of industrial land in London is an interesting one because it doesn't only affect industrial and manufacturing businesses. You may think that these things no longer have a place in London anyway, I do, but it does affect all of us. London is so expensive that its industrial areas now provide accommodation for a whole host of activities that need cheap, flexible accommodation or need to operate unencumbered by residents. So Alex's Block nightclub is a great example of that. More than 20% of London's SMEs are in industrial areas. So I leave you with a question. Is there a role for planning in all of this, or should we just leave it to the market? Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Jessica. Okay, Don, we're with you.
Right, thank you. Is London over? No, absolutely not. I think London has two specific aspects to it which make it very unusual. It has an incredible concentration of brilliant minds from all over the world that fit a sort of old world capital distribution, by which I mean all of the sort of layers of human endeavour are all in this place. We have the arts, politics, finance, entertainment, tech, sports. If you look at any federalized country like, say, the US or Germany, you'll see these distributed around different cities. And there are all sorts of sides to that, but one side of it is that as everyone mingles together, you start to see a sort of an emergent kind of debate and sort of frothiness that makes this a very exciting place to live. It also means this city is both very integrated intellectually, but also compared to even New York, it's a very culturally, ethnically, by national background, very integrated place, and I think that's very exciting. Now, there are two major challenges. The first, the biggest by far in my view, is housing. The second is the challenges presented by Brexit, as Mark alluded to, partly to do with the passporting and financial services. If that craters, then that'll have all sorts of immediate odd effects, but also, and I think more importantly, is the attitude to immigration and being an open, welcoming city in the future. But I've only got a few minutes, so I'll stick to housing. So the challenge is that the demand is increasing more quickly than the supply. Population growth in London is about 120,000 people a year. In a decade, we'll have about 10 million people living here. It's generally agreed about 50,000 units are needed to just sort of keep things at a sort of flatline basis, status quo. Now, in reality, the most ever units ever built in London were built last year, and that was a mere 30,000, so 2/5 of what's required. So this gap is driving up house prices, but it's also driving up rents as well. And in my view, rents get very little attention relative to house prices. They are not the same thing. And of course, now, plenty of people living in the city will never be able to afford to buy a house, so I think they need a bit more attention. Now, this is driving land values up, and it's an effect that's being differently distributed thanks to the Bank of England's mortgage multiple caps. Now, when you cap people's borrowings at about four times earnings and you add any sort of two London professionals' salaries together, of course, this is about much more than just professionals, but two salaries together, you're going to get a maximum they can pay of about £400,000 to £500,000 unless they're being given lots of cash by their parents. And you've seen a sort of shockwave emanating out from in a sort of donut shape. It's been tearing through Hackney, it's tearing into say, Tottenham right now, and you're seeing properties go up and up to about £400,000 to £500,000. And that's caused a much greater sense of gentrification around the city than was historically felt, because previously this was going on more in the centre and sort of bubbling away there. Now back to rents and the future of London. The year to April this year, rents rose on average of 7.7%. The average London rent was about £1,600 a month, so that's an increase in 1 year of about £1,400 in a year. Now, if that were to continue on a flatline basis for 10 years, the average London rent would be approximately £40,000 a year. Okay. Now, in practice, that won't happen, but we will see a much greater increase in densification, people living in overcrowded conditions. But a lot of people will just say, look, we're not going to do this, we're just going to leave. And the effect of this will be to lose a section of the creatives living here, many of whom are already moving to places like Berlin or to other UK cities. We'll lose academics, teachers, doctors, nurses, writers, entrepreneurs. I mean, even the commercial rents in Bristol are higher than the commercial rents in Singapore. In short, we'll lose people who are not the high earners, and what they'll do is it'll cause us to lose the diversity that makes the city so brilliant. Okay. The other effects it'll have, it'll mean a lot of money that could go into the local economy just goes into paying rents, which then goes into paying mortgages, which then gets syndicated over the global markets. And so if you compare our rents to Berlin's, we're paying £10 to £20 billion more on an equivalent basis. That's not going into the city economy. People are using property as pensions, which is not very good because it's not driving economic growth. It's sat there in the ground, and it's not going to work very well for them when they actually need to retire. And I was just chatting with a friend on Thursday who used to work at George Soros' hedge fund, and he'd seen evidence that suggested if we fixed the UK's housing crisis, we could see our GDP go up by 30%, okay, which is an incredible number. Now, what is the cause? The cause is it's hard to build houses, and the reason for that is planning regulations, and the reason for that is because planning regulations allow people to block things from being built. Politicians don't want to interfere with this because around half of people are homeowners, and so that's a battle they don't want to fight, particularly because homeowners vote a lot more than non-homeowners. And so the only real solution, really, at the end of the day, is political courage. Now, there are some more sort of granular, approximate solutions you can look at. A lot of them don't really get much airing in the press. Some do, building up, building out, building on the green belt. Just because you build on the green belt doesn't mean you need to build on all of it. You can zone bits of it. You can have garden cities or the like. And one thing which was suggested by Simon Jenkins, amongst others, which is if you look at London as a whole, and then you look at central London, it's a tiny bit of it, most of London is two-story terraced housing. If you look at Paris, most of the city is six or seven stories. Okay, you could take tranches of terraced housing, unlock money from the air, give people living in those existing housing money to pay off their mortgages and never have to pay rent or mortgage again, and build loads and loads of new housing. Okay, that's something that theoretically could be done. There doesn't seem to be much of an appetite for this right now. And then there's all sorts of more granular things. I think one thing that's overlooked is institutional money. There's a huge amount of pension fund money that could be tapped to build dedicated units just for rent. But again, this is something that's chronically underexplored in our market. And I'll just leave you with one little fact, which is related to property taxation. Now, I'm not a fan of using taxation to sort of drive down demand. But there is definitely a disparity between residential taxation and commercial taxation. So I just learned today, One Hyde Park, the council tax paid on one of those properties is £1,300 a year. Okay, the business rates paid by the Rolex store on the ground floor, which occupies a third of the floor plate of one of those flats, is £240,000 a year. Okay, something is out of whack here. And by the way, there's a side effect to this, which is when it comes to councils don't want to rezone commercial units as residential because they're just destroying their revenue base. So it's another weird, distorting aspect of our system. Anyway, that's enough for now.
Good stuff. Thank you very much.
Okay, store up your points and questions. But finally, Manira.
Okay,
So my answer to the question is London over? No. For all the reasons that people have already said, London is currently hugely successful in so many areas, in culture, in technology, in business, in education. It's very attractive still. I wouldn't say despite Brexit, I would say because of Brexit. But I think it has a huge appeal to international investors, to migrants who are looking for jobs, and it will continue in that vein. There are reasons why historically London has become successful, not just over the last 30 years, but over the last 400 years. It's had many different aspects and characteristics, which have meant that it's always been a hugely important creative capital, not least the fact that it is an incredibly important marketplace for the rest of Europe. And I can't see that changing, actually, over the next few years. I think for many reasons, the other cities, the rival cities in Europe, do not have some of the characteristics that London has, not least its sense of openness, its intellectual and creative base, the fact that it is a place that people actually want to live. And I'm sure Frankfurt is a very interesting place, but I'm not worried that the banks are going to decamp and go there, despite what people are suggesting. It's also a very resilient city and is capable of change. There's been, for a long time, a comparison between London and Paris. And I think there is a sort of consensus that Paris is a beautiful and elegant city, but because of the way it was planned, it's generally been quite difficult to adapt the Parisian architecture and the Parisian skyline. And because of the grand central planning of Haussmann, it's actually very difficult for Paris to adapt to a modern 24-hour international city. In the way that London has, to be debated. But I think there is something about the fact that London is incredibly diverse architecturally, the fact that the city was able to expand, even double its office space in the 80s and 90s to accommodate a growing financial centre. So London's resilience is partly about its adaptability. So all those things, I think, remain strong. However, we have to be alive to the real challenges and problems of London. And as Mark put it very well, we are to some extent victims of our own success, and we kill the thing that we love. London's openness to talent and to investment is also creating a distorting effect in many ways. And the area that's already been noted is the huge housing demand, which is a priority in all planning at local authority level and at GLA level. And that housing demand is driven certainly by international investors looking for a way to protect and save their money. They want somewhere secure. They want to put their assets into an economy where they know that they'll appreciate in value. But it's also driven by population growth. We will be 10 million people in 10 years' time. And I know that at the GLA, The population projections were always revised every year, and that 10 million figure has come closer and closer to us. It's growing faster than even the population, the demographic and analysts at the GLA could foresee. It's growing at a pace at which the infrastructure of London has not kept up. And despite investment in Crossrail and other transport, it is incredibly difficult with the state finances as they are to keep up with that pace of change. The consequence of that is that there are a number of other types of function in a city that are being crowded out. We've talked about the creative spaces, losing a third of artist studio spaces, a third of music venues, the impact on small businesses with the increasing in business rates that people have noted. And I think that there is already some provision in the London plan to try and deal with that. But essentially, it's in the face of huge population growth. Where are people going to live? And 50% of that population growth is migration. Whatever people think about immigration and the huge benefits it's brought to London, it has also brought this incredible challenge. And I don't know if we've really worked out how to adapt to it. The other thing about London is that its success has masked some of the failures in the wider national economy. and the rest of the country. And I think that the failures of various industrial policies in the regions, the fact that London has sucked talent and investment from around the country and also now increasingly around Europe, and the flight of talent and investment to London, which makes us look incredibly successful but has also created a distorting effect around regional economy, I think is a problem. And therefore it is important that, you know, the national government and in thinking about Brexit and post-Brexit life considers how we have a London that works for the rest of the country and not just for itself, that isn't a kind of independent city-state. Just one final point about house building. House building, I think it's fair to say, is now increasingly being delivered by very large house building organisations, by companies. There was a period of time in London where house building could be done at a smaller scale level by smaller companies. And I think that has changed. And it means that the kind of house building that we have in London relies on, has to be delivered through very large scale numbers of units. And that requires large amounts of overseas investment. And that again changes the kind of housing that you see gets built. So there's something there about the structural characteristics of the house building system, which have then created the kind of city that we live in and that people are feeling really uncomfortable about.
Excellent. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, who'd like to say something, ask questions, say something? Try and be brief because there's lots of us, but on anything at all.
If you look at the Netherlands, the capital area has many, many cities that are interlinked and they have their own space problems, but they work as a sort of whole and you don't really consider one of them as a single capital. Is that a vision that could be useful for London, to consider the whole region in a more balanced way?
So I think particularly around Brexit, there has been more talk around the divide between London and the rest of the country. Can you talk about kind of the negative impacts about the bubble that we're kind of in? I think it's a fabulous bubble, and I think everyone who lives in London genuinely loves the variety and the diversity that comes with the city, but I feel like more people are realising just how separate London is to the rest of the country, and I'd like to hear more about that.
So I was born and raised in London, and I'm lucky enough now to work for my favourite record label in London, but I've seen it change. I grew up in Hackney, and like when I was 17, like none of my friends wanted to come to Hackney. They were really scared of it. There were lots of gang fights going on. Obviously, I've now seen that all change, but it worries me that the kind of gentrification that I have been part of has pushed out a lot of people that I grew up with, and I just wonder what all your opinions are and your thought, the way that which you would like help not push those people out, and what you're doing to support those people that were born here.
I think it was Coolhaas that wrote back in the 80s about in generic cities that the defining feature of London is that it constantly becomes less and less like London. And I just wondered if perhaps, in a sense, London is dying. And it's that dying, that constant dying, that allows it to stay the vibrant, changing place that it is. And that perhaps it will be different in 5 years' time, because the London that we know today will be dead. But that in itself is a necessary process, and that London dying is not necessarily such a negative thing.
Good. Okay, so does anyone on the panel want to respond to any of these points so far?
Brexit, I can take that one, divide of the rest of the country. Yes, worrying. You know, London very clearly voted to remain in the European Union, and I think there are, you know, much of the rest of the country voted the other way, I think, feeling not just on the Brexit issue. I think that was merely part of the reason why people voted as they did. It was a feeling that they haven't benefited from, whether it's globalization, membership of the European Union, or other factors. And how we address that is difficult. The London is dominant in the British economy in a way that doesn't apply in some other countries like Germany, but does apply in countries such as France. There's a big variation about how that works. The solution is not to try to weaken London, but to try to ensure that the conditions are right for other centres to develop. And you look at Manchester, which has been stunningly successful in the past 20, 30 years, without, incidentally, anybody passing laws requiring it to happen, without having an elected mayor, which apparently the government thinks is the answer. So Manchester, having been incredibly successful, is now having an elected mayor imposed on it. So it is possible. And when I go, and I don't go nearly enough to other centres around the country, I do detect a big change from 30, 40 years ago when I first got involved, particularly in housing, which was along the lines of we're very poor, give us more money, to far more, we are a fantastic city, we've got huge advantages over London, our workforce is just as educated as anywhere else, they're highly skilled, they're adaptable, and our housing is a lot cheaper, therefore come to Liverpool, Birmingham, Manchester, Glasgow, Newcastle. And the cities that have got leaders that behave like that are going to be the successful cities of the future. And they do have huge advantages over London. Talking with Citigroup, which is one of the companies that's played a major part in revitalising Belfast, they think it's fantastic being in Belfast. They get top quality people in Belfast for the whole of their business, serving the whole of their business globally. So these things work out eventually, but it's up to the leadership of other cities, and if they're led well, and if the government does its bit, particularly on infrastructure, I think they can be equally successful.
I think the other big economic shift that's taking place is the dominance of the services sector to the British economy, and the fact that manufacturing has gone through this decline, even though we do produce more cars in Britain now than ever before, relative to the economy, manufacturing has taken a hit, and that's removed the possibility of high-paying jobs in other parts of the country, skilled jobs that people could access. And one of the boons of Brexit, you could argue, is the falling pound makes it easier to export. It makes those manufacturing companies much more competitive. And there's a sense of, again, trying to rebalance the economy. And actually, the City of London, the Corporation of London under Mark, has been, I think, very vocal about the need for recognising that London isn't just a financial centre, it's a centre for other types of activity. I go back to this point that I made, that London's success has masked all sorts of other problems. And it's not about saying we should therefore cut London or rubbish it or somehow try and take things out of London and put them somewhere else in a very artificial way. It's recognising that there are other problems around the country that we have to focus on. And actually, population growth in London, which has come from many parts of the UK, those people are coming to London because there aren't great centres where they can get great jobs in Manchester, in Leeds. It's changing, but it's changing too slowly. And I think there will be some rebalancing, which is a positive thing.
I just want to take a couple more people from the audience. There's a number of hands at the back.
In the famous words of Bob Hoskins in The Long Good Friday, this is the future. And he was talking about the Docklands. And the future. And I think one of the things is that I take the points about the exciting times, 2 million more people coming to London, and I think there's some really fantastic things about it. But I wonder what the panel think about two key issues. One is about our notion of scale and ambition for all types of infrastructure. I mean, I think that we're actually very lacking in bold visions for housing. We have very particular types of apartments that are built, but we need millions of houses and apartments in London and across the UK. And we're clearly not being provided with that, whether it's the market or the state or a combination of the two. So our scale in terms of infrastructure, 30 years for Crossrail, is it acceptable? Should we be much more ambitious like they are in Shanghai in terms of density, scale, in India, thousands of kilometres of roads? What's the view about scale and ambition? And the second thing is in terms of across the City of London and the 32 other boroughs, our view of the people. What is the view in the panel's experience of the people? Because it does strike me that there's a very cautious, nervous view of the public. That the only time it wasn't like that was during the Olympics, it seems to me, and there are some nice festivals, but often in terms of our discussion about the public, it's don't do this, don't congregate here, you mustn't do that. A range of different zones and conditions and impositions that affects all sorts of things from nightclubs to people using electric cars in the parks. And it sounds a bit ridiculous, but it does seem to me that in the absence of bold visions and ambition, the increasing regulatory outlook seems to rule the moment. So, you know, yes, London is exciting, but how could it be much better considering those two things from your views, please?
Under occupancy of buildings, so you get big modern developments of apartments and they get bought up, and actually the occupancy is very low. If you look at them at night in winter, very few lights are on. Is that a red herring or is that a significant issue?
Hi, I'm 26 and I wrote an article that went viral last week on why a Brit chose to start a business in Berlin. So I'm one person who's had to move to Berlin because I cannot afford to live here and start a business. I just thought I'd show myself as an example. I'm here for work, but yeah.
Great. It's great to see you non-digitally. All right, so I think, Don, you wanted to come in, and Jessica.
On the under-occupancy, I think it's slightly a red herring in that a lot of this stuff is going on in central London, and actually the sort of broader floor plate of London is much bigger. The solution, in my mind, is just to find people until they let those things out or sell them. It's as simple as that. I don't know how doable that is. I know there's use of council tax to try and make that happen. In terms of scale, absolutely, I totally agree. I think there needs to be bold measures taken, and there are incredibly sort of out there things you could theoretically do, like build Boris Island Airport, tear up Heathrow, and build a whole city where Heathrow is at. I don't think that's ever going to happen. On the point from the other round of questions about Brexit and the London bubble, I think this is indicative of a wider pattern going on in the world, which is a sort of bubblification, a sort of a polarization of people in lots of different countries on lots of different topics. It could be America with Trump, it could be the Middle Eastern conflict, it could be what's going on in European sort of political areas and arenas. I think there's a real empathy gap here. Half the country seemed utterly shocked that the other half the country could vote for Brexit. And I'm always curious why people think what they think about other people in the country. On what are they basing that opinion? Are they basing it on conversations with people they've met? Are they basing it on newspaper headlines? Because in my view, newspaper headlines do not reflect what most people think. They're designed to get a reaction. And most of them are designed to do a very specific thing, which is to make people feel angry. Because when people feel angry, they engage, they share stuff, they buy stuff. So you take very complex issues, and it could be anything, and it's translated into a narrative of who's the victim and who's the perpetrator of the crime, and because that's the only way you can assign a perpetrator and blame. And it creates a very simplistic public debate that I think is very divisive and very unhelpful. So my angle there would be don't delete friends on Facebook, tolerate dissenting views, have as many conversations with people who disagree with you as possible, and use it as an opportunity to refine your own thinking or convert them to your own style of thinking.
Jessica.
Oh, in a sec. So I was just going to respond to two points. One was on the scale and ambition of provision of infrastructure in London. I mean, the problem we have in London, which is very, very different to China and Shanghai, for example, is that we rely on development to fund our infrastructure. We can't just dip our hands in the pocket of government to do these things. And it means that if you look at, for example, Nine Elms and the way that that is developing now, that entirely linked to the infrastructure that's going in there. So we can't just put in infrastructure, build a load of houses. These things are very, very intricately linked in terms of the financing and the development in London. So things have to develop quite slowly, in a sense, here. The young lady from who was trying to set up a small business here and will be moving to Berlin, I'd really like to hear a little bit more from you, perhaps afterwards, to really understand what the barriers facing your business were. But I think the real issue here is that the market undervalues the potential of new businesses. We have no idea of knowing whether a new business is going to be successful or not. And so the market, in a sense, doesn't really know how to respond to new businesses. And so there has been a provision, an under-provision of small business workspace. And of course, workspace across London is being stripped out at an alarming rate from across high streets and industrial areas. If you look at the Old Kent Road, for example, they are speculating through the opportunity area that has been declared there that there will be a lot of new jobs, but all the existing businesses that are there have not been consulted on what is going on there. And there are thousands of jobs that might be lost from a location like that. This is happening all across London. There are 37 opportunity areas in London at the moment. So I think there is a problem of workspace provision, especially low-cost workspace provision in London. And I'd love to have a further conversation to understand more about the pressures. Thank you.
Yeah, But just to be clear, Jessica, on that point, there is a crisis, and you feel that that crisis is entirely solvable by planning regulation change.
No, I don't.
So, just to kind of...
Okay, so on planning, I think that, you know, planning has used a number of tools in the past. One is protecting employment land. The other is preventing the change of use from commercial to residential, for example. And these tools that we've had are harder to use now. So the government, national government, has basically allowed residential property to be converted now, sorry, the other way around, commercial property to be converted to residential without the need for planning permission. This is a massive, massive change. I know Mark has experience of this in the City of London. And so planning can actually do very little now. When we deregulate to that extent, planning really cannot even intervene. So I think we're facing the problem.
So just to leave that hanging, because what's going on here, there are conflicting trends coming up in our comments. One view of the world would be that the deregulation is a really bad thing, and therefore what we need to do is to control either the economy or development, more than we do today. There's another theme, and it's in a way reflected by the comments at the back, that in a way it's the sort of over-regulation of our messy, dirty city, which is causing it to fade away, as it were, and to kill that Alex's gargantuan mutating metropolis. You know, when you think about that kind of imagery, that's not something that's being controlled by policy people. So I just want to ask you to reflect on that issue. And then there's a kind of some brilliant themes here about the sort of the relationship between London and the rest of the UK, which I think links to this point earlier on about what's our vision of an expanding London. You know, is Manchester really, after all, a part of London in a longer view, in the way that Shanghai is connected to sub-districts that are, 80, 90 kilometres away? You know, can we create that kind of relationship between London and a much wider footprint? So what's your attitude to the growth of London and, linked to that ideas of immigration and so on? So that's what I'm beginning to hear. But I may not have it right, of course, so just help me on anything at all. I'll take another round of points. Again, start at the back.
My question's in relation to a media story that was happening in Sydney over the last couple of weeks, over the fact that millennials would rather spend their money on avocados on toast rather than investing in mortgages and property. And it did cause quite a bit of backlash. I don't know how many people saw that. But whether we think in London, this question of whether London is built on a generational one, and how is it possible when we're talking about regeneration and moving from areas and a city which is constantly changing to still integrate that into local communities which pre-exist?
As someone who's been through the planning process and got rejected 3 times before finally getting her appeal approved, and as part of my experience, I'm kind of wondering, has planning lost its way? In the sense that it's very much weighed towards the might of hefty developers, and for people that have a general vested interest in the community and the place that they live in, seem to be disadvantaged and therefore unable to have a proper discussion and conversation with planners and how they can make the places and spaces they live in better.
Would anyone on the panel agree with me that what might benefit London most of all in respect of all of this would be a good old-fashioned property crash? Or do you all own your own homes?
Well put.
Hello. I'm a little disappointed that actually no one on the panel disagrees, so there'd be a bit more of a debate. I also think
that
maybe...
You have to say something controversial then.
Yeah. I think it's also interesting to kind of flip the title of the presentation kind of on its head on are we over London? Because, a lot of the things that you're all discussing are kind of very big. They're themes of planning, and they're very much kind of overwhelming kind of themes, whereas there's little discussion about the individual. If you take the average Londoner who kind of works all of the time and doesn't have enough money to actually invest because they're giving all of their money to rent, so they can't actually have a foothold here. And you know, the actual conditions that we live in are pretty poor. The pollution, we don't really hear about like the space that we live in being improved for the individual. I wonder how you can kind of expect people to stay here and continue working when it doesn't really seem like it's getting better on a kind of individual level. Like, why are we all here? Like, working? Like,
should we be over London? Okay, and then maybe just here, then I'll come back to the panel.
I feel that the panel is very succinctly made the argument that London is successful, but I was wondering whether it is a success for everybody. If you could expand on, there's certainly a fear amongst my peers that London is becoming more homogenous, and that we are losing, we're losing diversity in terms of race, in terms of class, in terms of economic background. If the panel could expand on whether London is becoming less diverse over time.
I think that there have been a couple of excellent points made about the individual and the relationship to the city that the individual had. At the back, we talked about several fussy regulations about the way that people should behave in a public space, very specifically the way that we deal with nightclubs. It involves all of these tiny little micro rules about the way that people have to behave in the pavement, in the street, when they're on the way to the club, and also when they're leaving. Licensing and these kind of rules I see as being micro ways to treat people, almost after the fact. To bring this point back to the main theme of the discussion and the planning regulations and how we plan our cities, I think that there is absolutely a role for the planners to create spaces where we don't need to worry about having to regulate people's micro behaviour when they're there. And thinking about the experience of those people in the cities when we plan those areas, because that is something that planners do have the power to do. We've talked a lot about building houses and building more and more houses and more houses still, but I don't understand what kind of city that would be if we did. I don't understand where the space is for people to break out and simply to be, to work or to play. I think that planning has a big role to play with developers in order to guide a new residential development so that it has a social space, so that people can live in a city as well as sleep there.
Various people have said we're not disagreeing enough with each other, we're not saying enough controversial things. So I'm going to make one point, which is that I think that London government and people in London have been in denial about the fact that the population is growing so rapidly. And I know this from having worked in the GLA, that there was a lot of anxiety about every time we would release population statistics, which showed that London was growing. We'd have to explain why. And it was obvious to everyone that one of the reasons it's growing is because of immigration. And it's not to say that immigration is a bad thing, we should stop it. Of course we shouldn't, we should remain open. But we have to recognise that that has had the biggest single transformative effect on London and the growth of housing demand. And housing demand is what is driving a lot of the problems that people are concerned about. So the lady who talked about having to set up a business in Berlin probably would have had to do that because housing values have distorted land values, which means that it's better to have residential development than commercial development, office space development, which means that the office space development that's left, business rates are high. It means that it's incredibly difficult to set up a new business. It's also very difficult to set up new schools. We need 125,000 new school places in London in the next 10 years. Where are these schools going to go? So all the things that we talk about with London's diversity, the fact that we welcome immigration from around Europe and from around the world, of course they're positive, but it creates this incredible challenge. Now, I don't know what the answer is, but I can tell you that the answer is not simply, oh, let's just stop the housing development, because that's what a lot of people feel like. They look at the flats going up, and I think that a lot of the quality of the apartments and the houses that's been built are not very good. And I'm, you know, I've spent quite a long time in the last 8 years fighting against housing developments and arguing with our planners and insisting that, you know, we insist on some cultural use in there, and we change the style of some of the architecture. But fundamentally, if these are the You know, if we want London to be a diverse and welcoming place, if we want to welcome immigration, if we want the population to grow, that is the consequence of it. And there is a division within the city, not just between London and the rest of the country. There are a lot of incredibly rich people who can afford apartments in One Hyde Park. And there are many, many poor people who are coming from around Europe, particularly Eastern Europe and from outside Europe, who are coming, and they are the service class for those oligarchs. They are the Uber drivers, not just for the oligarchs, actually, for people like me. They're the nannies. They're the Uber drivers. They're the people who serve us in restaurants. That is the diversity of London that we love and cherish, but they have to live somewhere. So when people complain about all these housing developments taking place, going up, essentially, they have to come up with an alternative to it, and I really don't know what the answer is.
Last round of points. This is your opportunity. So,
first of all, I think that this is such a London thing to do, is talk about what we think about London, and is it over? Are we sure? We spend our whole time kind of questioning, do people like us? Like, do we like London? I don't know that this goes on in other cities. But,
you can only do it in London.
Well, it's wonderful to it's wonderful to hear, and I was sat here at the start, and I love the echo chamber of everyone talking really positively about it, and it's kind of, oh, I feel all warm and I can go off now. But yeah, there are other things as well. I think housing's always the one that kind of comes out, but I think as well as the sort of mass migration and also the sort of the movement of young professionals kind of coming in and dislocating previous communities. Someone spoke about the diversity element changing. I think the absolute numbers are still good. But the problem is that there's no longer those sort of small concentrations of neighbourhoods that make London so special and are kind of being driven out in some way. So you no longer get the critical mass of people in one area to drive
just
services.
Just to challenge you, so on that point, are you saying, therefore, that we should stop the development which is destroying that kind of fine-grained fabric of those neighbourhoods that you love? Or do you think that London should keep on growing and have more of those neighbourhoods but in different places?
I mean, maybe it should grow, but I think that as the commercial centre of London will continue to be the sort of the core, and as it kind of gets further out, it's still you still end up moving further away from the places that you work, and I think you do still lose that neighbourhood element slightly. I mean, for example, I'm a gay man. I think that the gay community in London has been decimated by sort of the closure of places in Soho and things like that. It doesn't feel like there's a neighbourhood anymore to kind of go to, which is actually really sad. It's nice to be accepted everywhere else, don't get me wrong. Like, I'm happy not to be stabbed or something like that, but there is something about being in a community amongst peers and feeling that sort of sense of community again that I feel is kind of sadly missing.
I wonder, Munira, why is it difficult to build social housing or schools? You know, we need them, and there is a lot of development. So I wonder, what is the obstacle? London seems so rich, and you know, for sure suburbs or neighborhood get through council tax money to build. And so what is the obstacle to build for, you know, ordinary people, social housing?
I'd like to come back on the commercial aspects, actually, because I run a business and I've been trying to have a premise for a business for about the last 5 years, and in that time it's been growth in the business itself. But in the last year or so, the rents have gone up by 30-40%. Huge increase for a business trying to start a, you know, get a commercial, go from one step of growth to another. That's a phenomenal increase. And in that time, we've also noticed the number of businesses that are churning, because businesses have come and started, gone out of business quickly because the rents are too high, they can't meet their costs. We also know of other really great bars in London, because we're buying people, that are really struggling now. Ones that have been there for a long time, that have been real centres, community centres, and they're having to close because their rents have gone up and their margin, they just can't make their margins anymore. So I do think there is something about stopping what the planning that we're allowing, these high-rise developments that have put the residential prices up, that then put commercial property up, it needs to change.
Don't you think that Brexit is going to solve all those problems with people leaving or at least stop coming to London?
Closing comments from the panel in the order that we did at the start. Alex?
I think that what we've learned, or what I've taken away, is that I believe that there is a role for planning to help plan our city of the future. And that city of the future cannot just be shrugging our shoulders and building houses right the way up until the horizon and just seeing what happens. Once the houses are built, everybody's got to live in the city which is built around them. I'd also like to pick up on two popular myths that I think I've heard today. The first is that setting up a business in London is hard. It's not. It's easier than it ever has been, and there's massive government support to do so for all sorts of startups. Business rates don't apply for businesses which can really be quite sizable, up to about 6 employees, something similar. Get small business rates relief. The second is that Berlin or Lisbon or any of these other places represent any kind of economic alternative to London in the cultural industries. They don't. Mm-hmm. Your overheads are lower, but you'll earn pennies. I know lots of people who've attempted to relocate to those areas. They all come back to London. The hustle is real, but the rewards are better.
Excellent. Okay, Mark.
I'm going to lob in a couple of facts. Last year, our population reached the staggering level that it was in 1938. You know, this notion that suddenly London has never had this many people. Really? You know, let's have a bit of history on this. In terms of workspace, I'm going to make these figures up. My colleague in the front row will correct me. I think in London, we're going up from 300,000 workers to 400,000 over a 10-year period. 420,000. So in terms of, you know, reduced work opportunities, hardly. And that's by space. In terms of setting up a business, when I set up my consultancy 17 years ago, I needed an office with a door and a filing cabinet. If I was doing it today, I'd do it in Starbucks. Okay? You go to Starbucks, that's where you see startups. And if you want more than Starbucks, you go to the Innovation Warehouse just around the corner. Or you go to the Google campus. Or if you want something more, you go to WeWork, a couple hundred meters from here, where a couple of thousand businesses are based there. I think it's never been easier in that respect. On housing, I agree with what Don has said. You know, the reason we don't have more housing is because of planning and because of government policy. London is not densely occupied in terms of housing units. You mentioned Paris, Barcelona, Madrid. All these cities have got much more dense housing than we have. And if you want to look at how to build housing, go to the boroughs that are doing it. Get on the tube and go to Barking and Dagenham. Mm. See what they're planning, 30,000 houses in 20 years. That's because they've got the leadership that wants it. Or Greenwich, or Tower Hamlets. These are the boroughs that want more housing and they've done it. And a final word on gentrification. We're incredibly proud of our academy in Hackney. When it started, the projected 5 A to Cs, including English and maths, was 32%. Actual figure, on their first cohort, 80%. Staggering. That leads to gentrification. That leads to increased values in that area because people want to be there. Spending power is higher and so on. But then other areas develop. And that's the sign of a dynamic economy. And London is a dynamic economy. It's big enough that it can absorb all these sorts of changes. No, it doesn't need to die, whoever said that. Near death will do. Just remember that expression. You know, it needs a shock every now and again, and Brexit will give it a shock. My final word, as I said earlier, if we handle Brexit correctly, London will remain stunningly successful.
Thank you. Jessica.
Mark mentioned Barking and Dagenham, so I just want to kind of finish with this as an example as what's happening in London. So Barking and Dagenham, they are going to be delivering thousands of new homes over the next however many years. But in doing so, I was down there 3 weeks ago looking at the areas that they're redeveloping for housing, the so-called growth areas. And yes, some of these areas are being developed on sites that really were completely and utterly vacant. So these are the first sites that are developed. What then happens is that the sites that then come forward in the next phase are on sites where businesses are there and they're operating well. And it's a really, really vibrant business community. And in fact, Barking and Dagenham is one of the biggest success stories in London in terms of its industrial jobs growth. And I really wonder what is going to happen to that over the next 10 to 15 years as housing really picks up a pace in somewhere like Barking and Dagenham. So my concluding remark is really, we have a housing crisis, yes, but I think we also have a workspace crisis. And I do think this is ultimately going to kill what we know as London today. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Don.
So to answer the point that the fellow mentioned about are we over London, I'll just share a personal story. I've been over London a number of times and left and moved to a number of cities around the world, seven different cities, in fact, including New York, Istanbul, Sydney. And I keep coming back, and I keep coming back because there's nowhere in my experience that's so stimulating, but more to the point, there's nowhere where you can be who you want to be regardless of where you're from, which does it quite like London, even New York. And I don't think that's going to go away. To the Brexit point, across those travels, I had three different people ask me to marry them, not because they wanted to marry me, but because they wanted to come to London. I had to politely decline, but that's not going to be impacted by Brexit. I can assure you. And then a little story from Istanbul. Now, living in Istanbul, I was surprised because you have a city of some 20 million people, but it never feels as busy as London, and it confused me. And the reason for that is you don't have one centre. You don't have this sort of heartbeat effect of everyone coming into the centre to work and everyone going out. You've got, I don't know, maybe seven or so different centres. And I'd like to think that with a little bit more political leadership, you could actually have people creating new centres which would actually offset a huge number of these issues if done properly in practice.
Manira.
Well, Mark's right, of course, that the population that we have now is not unprecedented, but there is a need for a higher number of dwellings because more people are living alone and they're living in smaller units. So it is having an effect on the housing market, and that is having, therefore, an effect on infrastructure and other public services that need to be built in these places. It's true that one of the issues with London is that we're still holding on to a structure or a plan of London, which is from the 1970s, for a population that's actually outgrown it. And we need to think of ourselves as more of a megapolis city. Now, that's going to change the culture of this city. It is going to change the culture of places like Barking and Dagenham. I used to say all the time in City Hall, Barking is the new Hackney, and people wouldn't believe me. And I said, but, you know, in 20 years' time, artists will be going there. It remains to be seen if that really will happen. It depends on the quality of the architecture and the quality of what's built. I do think there is a role for planning in that, and I wouldn't just want to leave it to the market because I think there are risks with that. Alan Miller is absolutely right. There are some things that the government shouldn't be involved in, the over-regulation of our personal interactions and social and cultural spaces. I think that has gone too far. But there are certain structural, infrastructural things that local government, better than national government as it happens, can do, and I think they should have the power to do it. But you know, London will evolve, but it will stop looking like the London that we know. And you know, that's something that, you know, if people want to welcome that population growth and that constant sense of change, then that's the consequence that they have to accept as well.
Thank you very much indeed.